So who is having the best sex anyway, and why? So this was from the book, Mary Roach's book, Bonk, which again I think is a great intersection between lay information, and she doesn't talk over anyone's head, but she really goes to the scientists that are trying to learn about this and collect information. So I thought that was pretty cool. But this was the findings here. So again, Masters and Johnson, that same group, but now in 1979. So they reported that they studied sexual encounters of all different sorts for 5 years, right? And they said the best sex being had by long-term committed gay and lesbian couples, right? Now, I have a suspicion, I know why this might be, right? That if you have the same plumbing, it's easier to dialogue. And they said that was absolutely true, that an empathy link, an actual appreciation for what the other person might be experiencing. Because not only are we all different, but there is differences between a male and female experience. And so we can learn from this, though. We can take, you know, for those of us that aren't lucky enough to be in a gay or lesbian couple and therefore still want to have good sex, for the het couples out there, this is some ideas that she had. And I just, these were so good, I had to just write them in a quote. So the straight man in most cases, I promise I'll bash the women too, but the straight man in most cases became so involved in his own sexual tensions that he seemed relatively unaware of the degree of his partner's sexual involvement. There was only a few instances when the husband seemed fully aware of his wife's level of sexual excitation and helped her to expand her pleasure rather than attempting to force her rapidly to higher levels of sexual involvement. So that was the, shake the finger at the husband's version. This is, again, in the 70s. But then the same thing went for the women in the heterosexual relationships that really... did a wife identify her husband's pre-orgasmic stage and actually suspend him in that level? So both of these suggest to us like a not understanding what the other person is experiencing, not really getting that this might be the place to continue and not just move on to the next stage. And this is a quote again from Mary Roach, but I loved it so much I had to include it. The empathy gap is not insurmountable, right? One only has to speak their mind. They just have to do the question, communicate, ask, talk, and we can probably get there, right? So for those of us that aren't lucky enough to already be in the kind of relationship that met the top of the list, then we have ways to try here, right? So some resources for your continued exploration. I have been known to give homework for almost every class that I've ever been in, so I think y'all know yours, right? You got your homework figured out? When you're done, then if you want to take a look at some interesting things out there, there's a really great, fun, light TED Talk that if you haven't discovered TED Talks, it's worth it just to discover them, and then you can watch this one if you haven't already. So 10 Things You Didn't Know About Orgasm, you get to meet the author then of the book and she's quite humorous. You can read her book, which again I think is both good for a lay audience, but also very communicative about real science. She's also the author of Stiff, which is a book about cadavers. And so that was actually how I first found her, is as an anatomist working in a cadaver lab. Someone said, oh, you got to read this. And she does great work intersecting with science and the science community. And then the other one is called The Science of Orgasm. And this is three different researchers have been working in the field. It's not as jazzy and interesting as Bonk, but it's got some real information about it that you can get. So I will leave you with an image to mull over while we end here. But basically, science really is trying its best, regardless of the fact that we're a fairly pretty culture, at least in this country. They're really trying to understand better what is happening. This in particular is an image during intercourse. So I'll try to help you out here. So they actually have a couple in the MRI machine, right? So they've got a couple in the machine. Against one another. This is the line between them, okay? This is the two bodies, okay? So here is the uterus. This is a vaginal canal, but it's full right now. And so here's the male body. Here's the two two pubic symphyses as the bony prominences that come close to one another. So you can actually, and here's again the real drawing to look at. So they were just trying to understand like what really does happen when these two bodies come together. But if you think it's awkward now, try it in an MRI machine. Even better than that, the one I thought was better yet is when she talked about both her, the author, and her husband went. She's a very adventuresome woman, so she went all over to really talk to the researchers doing this. And the best one is the guy doing an ultrasound. So her and her husband having intercourse, and he's sitting there with an ultrasound.